Years ago, I did a video on The Devil's Rejects, which is still one of my favorite horror movies.
I am the devil, and I am here to do the devil's work.
I know that a lot of people don't like that movie because of just how downright unpleasant and depressing it is. How the characters are impossible to root for, and every single moment on screen is joyless. To which I say, if you want to watch those same characters but actually have fun while you watch the movie, may I suggest the one that came before it?
Demonoid, but now made it down. Get it out, get it out.
House of a Thousand Corpses follows a group of young people traveling across the country, writing a book on weird roadside attractions. They hear about the legend of Dr. Satan, a local madman, and decide to investigate his whereabouts.
They took his ass out and hung him. And that infamous hanging tree is no more than a stone's throw away from where y'all's ass is now seated.
Along the way, they are lured into a house owned by the Firefly family, a group of deranged, dangerous psychopaths with a knack for showmanship, perversion, and experimentation with body parts.
Behold! Fish Boy!
All their attempts to escape or be rescued are thwarted, and only one of them survives as the rest are killed in strange and unusual ways by the members of the family, as well as the very person they were looking for, Dr. Satan himself. And she definitely survives at the end. Or does she? Now, the first thing you notice is that the editing and direction of this movie, especially for a first outing by Rob Zombie, is surprisingly good. Rockstar's transitioning to behind the camera doesn't always pan out well. There's a few good examples, like Dee Snider's Strangeland, which was pretty good, and Fred Durst's Fanatic, which came out this year and made so little money, it's almost art. Rob Zombie wasn't exactly a newbie at this. He had directed music videos before, and he always had kind of a crazy eye for weird animation and design. In case you've ever looked at any of his album covers from White Zombie, or the time he painted that set for Headbangers Ball and it took him like an entire year, when he is given the time and material to create something unusual, he goes all out. This movie was meant to be basically a send-up of old 70s exploitation and shock horror, which is why the main characters are so over the top of their expressions. It's why the blood is all brightly colored and shooting out everywhere, and everything is lit by neon.
A world where life and death are meaningless, and pain is God.
Woo! Hey!
The film also wastes no time thrusting you into the world that it creates, and just minutes after you're introduced to the main characters, you are taken on a literal carny ride of exposition.
Mr. Quayle was an intern at Willows County Mental Hospital. Nicknamed Weeping Willows for the never-ending cries of pain.
They fill you in on the lore of Dr. Satan and its relation to the setting, and I also like that in the ride, at least as far as this town is concerned, they hold S. Quentin Quayle in as notorious a group of serial killers as the likes of Lizzie Borden, Albert Fish, and Ed Gein. It's a strong statement. I really do love the murder ride, and I used to be able to quote it line for line, but the whole thing is stylized and bright, and it looks very creepshowish, very comic book oriented. And there are some scenes where the direct influences of this movie are really obvious. This is probably the most explicit. The whole concept of Captain Spaulding's Museum of Monsters and Madmen is a fantastic location that I really wish existed in real life, even with the benefit of hindsight, knowing I'd probably end up scalped or cut in half. I would still probably visit it.
Howdy, folks! Like blood, violence, and freaks of nature? Well, then come on down to Captain Spaulding's Museum of Monsters and Madness.
Some more locations that obviously had a lot of care put into them are the parts of the house where each of the family members live. You can tell just based on the rooms, there's a lot of personality attached to each wall. Baby's room is covered with dolls and pinup posters. Otis's room is just wall-to-wall dead bodies and cleavers and all sorts of maniacal crap. But if you want to talk about designs that I absolutely love, I love when they drive the characters underground. And you see that whole maze leading to Dr. Satan's workshop. Captain Spaulding informs the kids that Dr. Satan was kicked out of the hospital that he worked at for trying to make people into superhuman monsters, and you actually get to see a bunch of those test subjects, especially Mr. My Bloody Valentine 1.0 over here. But I'm so glad they didn't wimp out on this. Dr. Satan himself is one of my favorite crazy character designs. I love his gaunt, skinny-ass body and old, decrepit face with the surgical tools and wires coming out of his body. I love when he talks and he has that garbled voice. No! And supposedly, Dr. Satan wasn't actually meant to be a real guy in the original version of the house. It was supposed to be just a story that they used to lure stupid people into the pit. But I love the idea that he was real and in business. When I think of a deranged underground surgeon, and I'm promised that by a guy written by Rob Zombie, this is what I come to expect.
He'd really like to know. Enlighten him!
Well, I bet you'd stick your head in the fire if I told you you could see hell.
The real bread and butter of this movie, though, is the Firefly Clan itself. Every member of this family is so much fun to watch. It takes less than half the runtime of the movie before we're introduced to the whole Firefly family, which of course is done at a dinner table.
You got a demon sticking out your ass singing, "Holy Miss Moly, got me a loud one."
Now, what other horror series is really focused on family dinners? I wonder.
If someone needs to be killed, you kill them. That's the way.
Baby's depicted as a starlet, a childlike brat with a high-pitched voice and cackling, disturbing laugh.
Shoo, shoo, said the maiden.
This is clearly a part that was written for Sherry Moon Zombie, and I know a lot of people aren't too keen on her. She's completely hit or miss with fans. I think for this particular instance, she's awesome. She just buys into the gimmick completely and runs with it as hard as she can. Sometimes literally in the case where she's chasing down bunnies.
They all run like scared little rabbits.
Run, rabbit, run!
Otis B. Driftwood, played by Bill Moseley, is certainly Bill Moseley at his most Bill Moseley. He's a fixture of cult films like Texas Chainsaw 2 and Repo the Genetic Opera, and you can tell when he is completely enjoying a role. Which is why I love watching him on here, because as hateful and despicable as Otis is, you're never driven away when he's on screen. You really want to keep watching him do horrible crap.
And I'm the one who loves you when you're fucking there!
But of course, we had to talk about this movie this year because, unfortunately, Sid Haig passed away. Now, Sid Haig had a long career behind him in the film industry, but I think he had his golden moment to shine when he put on that clown paint and became Captain Spaulding. Captain Spaulding is an interesting character in this movie because he's a constant presence in the film, even though he only stays in one place, and main characters don't even interact directly with him outside the gas station.
Do yourself a favor, son, just forget about it.
Oh, come on, I live for this shit.
Okay, all right, I'll draw you a damn map.
Captain Spaulding up the road at him.
That old bitch hog don't know shit.
They caught a gander at the display in the back, and they figured they was gonna run out and solve the great Deadwood mystery.
And how'd they get that idea?
I wrote him a map.
But here's the thing. The other members of the Firefly family, they're very one note. Baby is playful and giddy but insane. Otis is loud and sadistic and maniacal and insane. But Captain Spaulding, you don't really get a good beat on.
Who the hell want to read about all this horse shit anyway?
You'd be surprised.
Son, look around. Would I be surprised?
He's friendly enough at first. He's very welcoming. But the longer you talk to him, the more you see that darkness inside of him.
Hey, little Dickinson, I know what your problem is.
What's that?
Y'all think us folks from the country's real funny-like, don't you?
And I absolutely love the cold, dead stare he gives to people who piss him off.
Nothing. Stupid-ass kids probably got themselves turning around ass backwards and got themselves lost.
Whew. Jesus. Now, if you've never heard of these characters before, you're probably wondering where the hell they're getting these names from. They're all from the same family, but Baby, Firefly, Otis B., Driftwood, Captain Spaulding? I'm not sure if I've ever really made this known outside these videos, but I am a huge Groucho Marx fan.
Why don't you go home to your wife? I'll tell you what, I'll go home to your wife, and outside of the improvements, you'll never know the difference.
My dad and I used to watch old Marx Brothers movies together, and I still make it a tradition to watch Duck Soup on my birthday every year.
Not that I care, but where is your husband?
Why, he's dead.
I'll bet he's just using that as an excuse.
So naturally, I caught on pretty much immediately that every character of the Firefly clan is named after one of the characters played by Groucho Marx in his movies. Captain Spaulding is the name of his character in Animal Crackers. Otis B. Driftwood is his opera manager character in Night at the Opera. One of the members of the family, Grandpa Hugo, is obviously supposed to be Hugo Quackenbush from A Day at the Races. And even the name of the family, the Fireflies, is named after Rufus T. Firefly, the leader of Fredonia, and the lead character in Duck Soup.
Haven't we seen each other somewhere before?
I don't think so. I'm not sure I'm seeing you now. It must be something I ate.
They never actually mention this until the sequel, and it doesn't really play into anything in the story. I just think it's an interesting little Easter egg, and I got a kick out of it. Holy crap, if they didn't make that Miyazaki movie, this film could have probably been called Grave of the Fireflies.
I love you, Mama.
Hello.
But the movie does definitely have flaws, but it's Rob Zombie's first, so I can understand why. I think that there are some scenes that drag on a bit too long, especially the torture scenes or the shots of dead bodies. There are times where I feel like the film that's trying to replicate really overpower any message the movie's trying to tell you. Also, it's got a bit of a tone problem. Not to mention that the cinematography shifts in style at least 4 or 5 times every 10 minutes, and I never really think it adds anything. I think it just detracts from the movie as a whole. I would have preferred it without those testimonials and the grainy footage every now and then, but that's just me. That being said, even with the flaws, I think that the whole movie is worth the watch just for the one scene when they discover the bodies. For a lot of the movie, they follow two cops as they investigate one of the girls that went missing, and you eventually do find their investigation coming to a head at the house, and I'm going to apologize to every Slim Whitman fan out there because this scene will ruin I'll Remember You for you.
I remember you. You're the one who made my dreams come true.
The slow-mo actually adds to the horror. There's those great looks of shock on the cops and the father's faces, the effects for the gunshots. It is such a crazy scene, and it ends with one of my favorite shots in a movie ever. So yeah, maybe a change in style is appropriate every now and then, but just don't overdo it next time.
It's all true. The boogeyman is real. And you found him.
This movie's not perfect, but for a first outing by Rob Zombie, it's surprisingly solid. The story is pretty consistent, and it definitely keeps your attention for the full hour 20. It's just all in all one of the more fun, schlocky horror films I've seen in a while. And not just for me watching it, but it looks like they had a blast making this as well. I highly recommend checking out the bonus features in any edition of the movie you can get, because it's filled with testimonials of the actors enjoying their time on set, joking around with each other in character, and answering questions from fans.
See, I would love to see this film in one of those, like, little theaters where people talk to the screen and everything, because I have a feeling it's going to get real noisy.
Sid Haig clearly had a blast in this, as he talks about the character, he hangs out in costume, and there's even a little extra on the DVD menu, which takes place inside Captain Spaulding's museum. And what I love about this is, if you hang around and do nothing for long enough, he gets really pissed off, and it's hilarious.
Y'all city slickers think you can come in here and just waste my whole goddamn day, don't you? Well, hell with that. Get the hell on out of here. I got me some chickens to be dealing with.
Now, obviously, Rob Zombie would go on to direct a sequel to this film in The Devil's Rejects, which I've already talked about, and a finale called Three from Hell, which I did not see yet because I usually work nights and it was only out for four of them. But I'll get to it eventually because I am dying to see Sid Haig's final performance. He made this movie. I can pretty much guarantee you he's going to make the next one. Rest in peace, Captain. Tutti fucking fruity.
Most of all, fuck you! Goddamn motherfucker got blood all over my best clown suit.
Next time, we're going to take a look at the most realistic documentary about vampires I've ever seen.
Oh, no. Peter Gotten.
Poor guy.
25!